Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. What is to be done? Burning questions of our movement. Conclusion. The history of Russian social democracy can be distinctly divided into three periods. The first period embraces about 10 years, approximately from 1884 to 1894. This was a period of the rise and consolidation of the theory and program of social democracy. The adherents of the new trend in Russia were very few in number. Social democracy existed without a working class movement, and as a political party it was at the embryonic stage of development. The second period embraces 3 or 4 years, 1894 to 98. In this period, social democracy appeared on the scene as a social movement, as the upsurge of the masses of the people, as a political party. This is the period of its childhood and adolescence. The intelligentsia was fired with a vast and general zeal for struggle against Narodism and for going among the workers. The workers displayed a general enthusiasm for strike action. The movement made enormous strides. The majority of the leaders were young people who had not reached the age of 35, which to Mr. N. Mikhailovsky appeared to be a sort of natural borderline. Owing to their youth, they proved to be untrained for practical work and they left the scene with astonishing rapidity. But in the majority of cases the scope of their activity was very wide. Many of them had begun their revolutionary thinking as adherents of Narodnaya Volia. Nearly all had in their early youth enthusiastically worshipped the terrorist heroes. It required a struggle to abandon the captivating impressions of those heroic traditions, and the struggle was accompanied by the breaking off of personal relations with people who were determined to remain loyal to the Narodnaya Volia and for whom the young social democrats had profound respect. The struggle compelled the youthful leaders to educate themselves, to read illegal literature of every trend, and to study closely the questions of legal Narodism. Trained in this struggle, social democrats went into the working class movement without for a moment forgetting either the theory of Marxism, which brightly illumined their path, or the task of overthrowing the autocracy. The formation of the party in the spring of 1898 was the most striking and at the same time the last act of the social democrats of this period. The third period, as we have seen, was prepared in 1897 and it definitely cut off the second period in 1898. This was a period of disunity, dissolution, and vacillation. During adolescence the youth's voice breaks. And so, in this period, the voice of Russian social democracy began to break, to strike a false note on the one hand, in the writings of Messrs. Struve and Prokopovich, of Bulgakovy and Berdyevy, and on the other, in those of the LN and RM, of Bykrychevsky and Martynov. But it was only the leaders who wandered about separately and drew back. The movement itself continued to grow, and it advanced with enormous strides. The proletarian struggle spread to new strata of the workers and extended to the whole of Russia, at the same time indirectly stimulating the revival of the democratic spirit among the students and among other sections of the population. The political consciousness of the leaders, however, capitulated before the breadth and power of the spontaneous upsurge. Among the social democrats, another type had become dominant, the type of functionaries, trained almost exclusively on legal Marxist literature, which proved to be all the more inadequate the more the spontaneity of the masses demanded political consciousness on the part of the leaders. The leaders not only lagged behind in regard to theory, freedom of criticism and practice primitiveness, but they sought to justify their backwardness by all manner of high-flown arguments. Social democracy was degraded to the level of trade unionism by the Brentano adherents in legal literature, and by the tail-enders in illegal literature. The credo program began to be put into operation, especially when the primitive methods of the Social Democrats caused the revival of revolutionary non-social democratic tendencies. If the reader should feel critical that I have dealt at too great length with a certain Rabe K. Diallo, I can say only that Rabe K. Diallo acquired historical significance because it most notably reflected the spirit of this third period. Footnote 1. It was not the consistent R.M., but the Weathercock Krzyzewskis and Martynovs who were able properly to express the disunity and vacillation, the readiness to make concessions to criticism, to economism, and to terrorism. Not the lofty contempt for practical work displayed by some worshipper of the absolute is characteristic of this period, but the combination of pettifogging practice and utter disregard for theory. It was not so much in the direct rejection of grandiose phrases that the heroes of this period engaged as in their vulgarization. Scientific socialism ceased to be an integral revolutionary theory and became a hodgepodge freely diluted with the content of every new German textbook that appeared. The slogan "class struggle" did not impel to broader and more energetic activity but served as a bomb, since the economic struggle is inseparably linked with the political struggle. The idea of a party did not serve as a call for the creation of a militant organization of revolutionaries, but was used to justify some sort of revolutionary bureaucracy and infantile playing at democratic forms. When the third period will come to an end and the fourth, now heralded by many portents, will begin, we do not know. We are passing from the sphere of history to the sphere of the present and, partly, of the future. But we firmly believe that the fourth period will lead to the consolidation of militant Marxism, that Russian social democracy will emerge from the crisis in the full flower of manhood, that the opportunist rear guard will be replaced by the genuine vanguard of the most revolutionary class. In the sense of calling for such a replacement and by way of summing up what has been expounded above, we may meet the question, what is to be done? With the brief reply puts an end to the third period. Notes 1. I could also reply with the German proverb Den Sack ist schuld die Genie man, den Esel mein man, you beat the sack, but you mean the donkey. Not Rabe K. Diallo alone, but also a broad mass of practical workers and theoreticians was carried away by the criticism de la mode, becoming confused in regard to the question of spontaneity and lapsing from the social democratic to the trade unionist conception of our political and organizational tasks. Lenin,